Join Charles and Hillary Price as they journey to Iraq and Lebanon to find out how God is at work in the Middle East.
Hello, and welcome to Iraq. This week, Living Truth is coming to you from northern Iraq, an area that is known as Iraqi Kurdistan. We're here to follow up on the programs we broadcast last year when we were getting ready to launch Living Truth in Arabic. And subsequently, in January of 2014, we began to broadcast throughout the Arabic-speaking world in the Arabic language. For the next 3 weeks, we'll show you how your financial support has been put to work. And we'll bring you stories and testimonies from Kurdistan and from Lebanon. My wife Hillary is with me this year, and she'll be bringing some of the reports.
Dreams about what you want to do.
She's already familiar to Living Truth viewers, and I know she is much appreciated by many of you. Later in the program, we'll give you an opportunity to participate with Living Truth to strengthen the Arabic broadcasts. Out of the immense turmoil of recent years, people in the Middle East are looking for peace, not just collectively, but personally, deep in the human heart. Some of these people are finding real peace, the peace that only Jesus can bring. The stories you're about to see were filmed some months ago when northern Iraq was more peaceful. At that time, Christians were enjoying a degree of religious tolerance and freedom. But the events of the past few months have plunged Iraq back into turmoil. An extremist army is sweeping down from Syria into Iraq. Religious minorities are in great danger. Christians are fleeing for their lives to Erbil with little more than the clothes on their backs. Thousands of displaced Christians are camping in churches, tents, or on the street. This turbulent part of the world, now more than ever, needs the gospel. They also need short-term practical help in the form of emergency aid. Later in this program, we'll tell you how you can help our brothers and sisters in Erbil, in Iraq, Kurdistan, who are facing persecution simply for believing in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. So stay with us for the next hour as Living Truth travels to the Middle East for the Kingdom of God. I'm in the city of Erbil in northern Iraq. The Kurdish people are a majority here. The Kurds were known as the Medes in the latter Old Testament period. Kurdistan is a semi-autonomous region within the greater Iraq, with its own government. But even in this region, there are dangerous consequences for people who turn from one faith to another to become a Christian. Our first story is about a man who did just that, and he is prepared to bear the cost.
This is the Kurdsman Church, a church that ministers to Kurdish-speaking Christians. They are mostly converts to Christianity from another religion.
This is a lovely building.
Yes.
Majid Rashid is the pastor here. He worked for over 5 years to get the government to register the church as an official denomination.
We would love to have filmed a service here, but that is not possible because all the people here are converts.
Yes.
And we cannot show their faces, cannot reveal their identities.
We can say that this is dangerous, actually. When they are appearing on the TV, the people, they have relatives. They might see him as well. So they are going to persecute him, threaten him, or kill him.
Have you been arrested?
Yes.
Have you been imprisoned?
Yes, 3 times.
How did you become released?
When they were investigating, they find nothing against us. So that is why they released us.
So it's intimidation, really. It is to threaten, cajole, make you feel isolated.
Yes.
Majid became a Christian during his university years, but his spiritual search began in high school.
What happened to make you aware of Christ and to bring about your conversion?
In 1999, one of my brothers, he was a policeman and he was killed. While we were burying his body, I just thinking about life and death.
Majid turned to the religion of his birth. For 2 years, he prayed and fasted and tried to keep all the religious laws.
I had a lot of crimes in my life before. While I was trying to find the forgiveness of God in my life, I was beating my sister every day.
Why?
Because she was going out. And sometimes she was not covering and not dressing. So I was beating her. And sometimes I tried to kill her. The teachers at school, they were telling us if my sister didn't obey it and if they didn't listen to us, we are allowed to kill them easily.
Majid started to listen to religious readings on the radio. But one night, while tuning in, he found an unexpected message.
Once I just heard something about God, the love of God, the presence of God in human beings' life. It was my first time to hear such strange and attractive, wonderful words in my life.
Majid was listening to a Christian radio program. He heard for the first time that God was a loving God. Every night he listened in secret. At the same time, his teacher warned his class about reading the gospel in the Kurdish language. Majid recognized the word gospel from the radio broadcast.
He said, "Do not, Majid, do not read it, because this book is really destroys your faith, and you might lose your faith." I said, "No, teacher, I really want to read it. I want to know what this book talks about." He said, "Okay, but your blood is on..."
Your blood is upon your own neck.
Yes. I said, "Okay, I'm accepted." And I took back the gospel home and started to read it. When I started to read the gospel at home, this was my first time to realize that God exists. And God is knowing everything. And God is in our hearts.
One of the stories that riveted Majid was the story of the woman caught in adultery. Jesus said to her accusers, "Let he who is without sin cast the first stone." He recognized his own sin.
And every second this verse was coming to my mind and challenging me. Every day I was screaming out and crying, weeping. And no one was able to help me. And I really, in the last day, I still remember, I tried to kill myself. And I screamed out with all my power, "Please God, is it true what the Bible talks about you? I want to know." A peace came to my heart, and I have never felt and experienced such peace. When I went back home, I hugged my sister, and I kissed her. I told her that I'm sorry.
His parents noticed this dramatic change in his behavior. They wanted to know why. He showed his mother the book.
She said, "What is that?" I said, "This is the gospel," very openly. She said, "Why you are bringing such curse into our home? This is the book of Christians."
His father issued a stern warning before throwing him out of the house.
And he told me, "So I'm warning you not to talk about this anywhere."
But Majid could not stop talking about it. He accepted Christ and began to attend a church. There he met his wife, and they now have two sons. The children are paying the price for Majid's conversion. They cannot be registered as Christians, so they are not registered at all. To this day, the children have no ID papers. They cannot go to school or access health care.
And I know still today, your parents cannot have friendship with you, with your family, with your children. I know that you're still ostracized from them because of this.
Yes.
You are now leading a congregation of similar people who've come to Christ. How do you minister to them in this situation where they've had to literally, as the New Testament says, deny their father and mother and turn from them in order to be faithful to Christ?
When someone comes to Christ, first of all, I'm talking about the persecution to him. Are you ready to accept it or not? Because you will be killed, you would be persecuted. Every bad thing may happen to you, but we are not denying the eternal life in Christ Jesus the Lord.
Pastor Majid's words were tragically prophetic. Since filming this interview, thousands of Christians have been threatened with death and forced from their homes in northern Iraq. They have fled to the city of Erbil for safety. Majid has opened his church to 35 families. Here's an update, courtesy of Christian Broadcasting Network.
The Kurdsman Church transformed their building into a true sanctuary.
The building is for the humanity.
Pastor Majid Mohammed opened doors for both Christians and non-Christians.
We wanted to show those people, we don't care that they are Christians, Yazidis, Muslims, we don't care about that because they are human beings and they have been fired out, kicked out at their home by ISIS and the terrorist groups. So this is why we wanted to show them that as a Christians we love them and we are very glad to have them here and serve them.
This man led a mini exodus of several families to the Kurdsman Church.
On behalf of all the people right here, Pastor Majid is really showing the love of Jesus.
You are watching For the Kingdom of God, Living Truth in the Middle East.
Many of you viewers of Living Truth are very loyal and generous towards us, and for that, we're deeply grateful. We were overjoyed at the support we received when we told you last year we were going to produce an Arabic version of Living Truth. We always want to be good stewards of the funds entrusted to us, so I want to tell you exactly how your donations have been put to work. Here's a report on the Living Truth production team.
As soon as donations were received, a production team with a passion for the Arabic world got to work. It's led by Ibrahim Wabi.
We find ourselves have this passion toward the Arab world. At that time, I was praying for missionaries overseas in the Middle East and in very hot areas because of political upheavals and things like that. And I found this is one of the answers of my prayer.
The first task was to choose the right message to launch the program.
I started to pick what addressed the needs for the time being in the Middle East. So we started with a series called Impact, When People Meet Jesus. And I found this series profound because we need people to meet Jesus.
The next step was to translate the message into Arabic and record the voice.
سأحدثكم اليوم عن فكرة النمو في الحياة المسيحية وسأبني هذه الفكرة على آية.
Peter Musa is the Arabic Charles Price.
What we do is not we're transferring the service to the Arabic language, But we are transferring Charles Price to be the Arabic one. So I'm trying to give the same passion, the same attitude, the same feelings of the Charles Price.
The recording replaces the English soundtrack, and Charles appears to be speaking Arabic.
لم تكن كل اللقاءات بيسوع إيجابية التأثير، بعضها كان سلبيا.
It's difficult to synchronize the soundtrack with the visuals. But for this professional team, it's not just a TV production job. It's a mission.
It's for the Lord. I got really blessed when I first started in the first series, Impact, when people meet Jesus. I was really touched by the program itself, and I was like, wow, I've heard a lot of like this kind of messages before in this the same topic. But nobody handled it in this kind of a simple, unique, it's amazing teaching. People can really, really appreciate that because of what's happening back home in the Middle East nowadays. Literally, I got the chance to convey the message of the Lord all over the globe, and this is something really encouraging.
Hakika Haya, that's Living Truth in Arabic, is broadcast on Al Karma TV, a network of 6 satellite stations based in California. The program went on air for the first time in January 2014.
Karma TV is one of the best channels that broadcasting to actually, I can say, 98% of the world.
Viewers can also access the program through streaming video on the website. Taleen Parsikian monitors the site and is the frontline contact for viewers who want to know more about Christ.
We receive emails from all around the world. We receive emails from different backgrounds. And if there is a way of connecting them to churches to attend and to grow in, we do that as well.
Arabic Christians are pleased that the teaching of Charles Price is now available in their homelands.
There is so many Arab people that attend Hakika Haya now on TV, either in North America or overseas as well. And they actually have the benefit of understanding what the Word of God means. They understood the salvation in a very simple way and also in a practical way. And it affects them and their families as well.
In the Arab world, there are people that have never heard the gospel and the teachings of Jesus, and that this will give them the opportunity to come to Jesus and know Him.
This type of work, missionary work, is costing, right? And it costs not only money, not only costing your donations, it costs sometimes for some people their life. This type of teaching, it's changing people, and that's why we reach Arab world for Christ.
We're hearing some remarkable stories on the one hand here in Iraq. We're also hearing some tragic stories. Often these two things do go together. A man this morning told me that 8 members of a particular political party had become Christians, one by one, had all joined his church. Every one of them has been martyred and put to death. We need to pray for this part of the world, because in the midst of all the turmoil that is here, God is at work.
But even in Syria, we know that God is bringing many people to Himself because of the crisis. In the middle of the difficulty, this is the time for God to intervene supernaturally and to lead people to think and to see the light as more than ever before. So I'm seeing the whole picture as if God is shaking all the Arab world in different ways. But from inside, we are seeing people coming to Christ, which is, for us, the most important thing in the kingdom of God.
And we have seen a lot of people are coming to Christ. We have seen a lot of people where their life were changed. They have a church in their rooms with a Christian channel. They worship God through these channels because they can't attend a public church. this is the place where they can receive spiritual food. This is a place when they can receive a comfort. This is a place, you know, when they're watching these programs, they can be built as a Christian. And they can follow Jesus in a right path.
Christ-centered Bible teaching on Arabic television is not just for genuine believers, though we love the opportunity to feed their souls, but also for those who are cultural Christians and for those of other religions or of none. Our goal is to lead people into a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. The woman you're about to meet found that Christian programs on satellite television drove her to the Bible and from the Bible to Christ Himself.
Ashti Andrawas attends this evangelical church in Erbil with her teenage daughters. Here she has learned to worship, pray, and depend on Jesus in all aspects of her life. It wasn't always the case. Ashti and Hillary sat down together to talk about how she found Jesus.
I did not have a deep faith as a child, but I remember when the light went off, I used to be very scared, and my mom would tell me not to be afraid. She told me that if I draw the sign of the cross, Jesus will be with me. I believed her, and I really felt that Jesus was with me.
Ashti was born into an Orthodox Christian family in Iraq. Like many, her faith was simply part of her culture rather than a real relationship with God. But she always had a spiritual longing.
So when did you move from a childlike belief to an adult growing up and believing for yourself?
When I was in my 20s, I went to Baghdad and I started attending a traditional church. I used to listen to some biblical teaching, thought I was a real believer, but I later realized that at that time I was simply interested in the information.
So where else did you search for God at that time?
After I got married, we had many problems and difficulties, and I turned to God and started praying. However, things got worse. I started thinking there is no God and no Christ. Because if there is a God, why does He allow these things to happen? I watched evil people living a better life than I am. I was angry with God.
This was a crisis time in Ashti's life. She didn't know where to turn to find answers. One day she was watching television and she heard a teaching she had never heard before.
I started watching Christian channels on television, and I started hearing strange teaching, a teaching I had never heard before. I started searching in the Bible when they quoted verses, because I was not familiar enough with the Bible. So I wrote all the passages down and searched for them later.
You said you were really angry. Then you watched the television, you started to read the Bible. You watched more television. How did your relationship move on from there?
I started praying with the people praying on TV. I had never seen people pray like that. In the past, I've always prayed a prayer that I memorized or read. But when I saw them pray, it was like they're saying what I want to say in my prayer. So I started praying with them, and my relationship with God started to grow. I wanted to talk to Him more, and felt that He heard me.
At first, Ashti found the Christian life difficult. She went to the Bible to find answers for herself. She also went to a Christian center, where the teaching built on what she had learned through television.
This new faith affected my life dramatically. First, I now have a relationship with God. Now I can say I know Him. Even my view of people changed. I used to hate evil people and resent them. After my new faith, I'm able to forgive. I was holding grudges against those who hurt me. and I was very burdened. After my faith, I forgave these people, and I felt very released from my burdens, and I was able to even love them, those who hurt me.
So from your own experience, how important would you say it is for Christian television in your own language to be available here?
Christian channels are very important. When I used to go to masses, I wasn't able to understand all the teaching I heard. Many things were confusing, but in the television programs, they simplify things for us, and that helps me understand much more.
Christian television, delivered via satellite into Ashti's home, led her to the Bible, then to a church, and eventually to Christ. There are still difficulties in her life, but she has learned to take those difficulties to Jesus.
The Christians of Iraq claim to be one of the most ancient Christian communities in the world. But they're facing tough challenges. Iraq is organized along ethnic and religious lines, and Christians are a small minority. So when an evangelical church from another Middle Eastern country came to host a prayer conference, pastors and church leaders came from miles around seeking encouragement, teaching, and prayer.
Charles was invited to speak at the prayer conference held in this church in Erbil, Kurdistan. Pastors and church leaders came from all over northern Iraq. Some came with stories of harassment and persecution. They left with sound biblical teaching and the prayers of the community. The worship, the prayers, and the teaching were all recorded and broadcast live on YouTube. Media was vital to share the conference with the Arabic-speaking world. The pastor of the host church was Pastor Hassan.
When we built this building, we said, Lord, this is not our building, this is yours. So do whatever you want to do. So God put in our heart to be a blessing for other people and other nations and other churches also. So that's why we like to host conferences like that, and also to make people understand that without prayer we cannot do anything. That's why we like to host these conferences and invite people to come and pray and ask the Lord to do mighty things.
At the time of the conference, Erbil was considered safe, especially in the Christian suburb of Ankawa, where churches like this one are located. But this pastor from the city of Mosul was already experiencing harassment.
Our city is considered one of the difficult cities because it's one of the hot spots in Iraq. The city is close to evangelism because of the fanatics.
How do you deal with the difficulties that you have to live with?
Prayer is first and foremost, and the support we show each other through our personal relationship. The biggest difficulty that we face is checkpoints. In Mosul, there is a checkpoint every 500 meters, so it makes transportation very difficult. The next difficulty is kidnapping. Our church has lost two martyrs, which cause fear among many preachers.
This pastor foreshadowed the tragic events that began just a few months after the conference was held. In the face of a rapidly advancing extremist army, all the Christians were driven out of Mosul. They fled to Erbil and were sheltered in churches and camps. Perhaps this prayer conference strengthened the Christian community to withstand the tragedy that was to come.
The Iraqi church needs prayer more than anything else. We need people from outside to pray for the Iraqi people, because what's happening when prayer is taking place, things are starting to happen here. People start to see dreams and visions. Even without anyone reaching them, But I had people come to the door of the church, knocking the door. They are asking that, we want to know about Jesus. And I tell them, how do you know about Jesus? Why do you know about him? Because they tell me that I have seen him in a dream. Yeah. I saw a vision.
And we are thrilled to see what God is doing without human agency. Normally he works through human beings, but direct revelation that God is giving to people's hearts and souls, through dreams, visions, all kinds of things, because he's speaking right into people's hearts. Behind me, you see the folks who have gathered here for this prayer conference you've just been hearing about. They've come from all over northern Iraq, church leaders and their spouses, and we have helped to sponsor some of them who otherwise could not afford to be here. It's very evident to us that the kind of teaching we can provide to Living Truth through radio, television, through the internet and literature is so very much needed in this part of the world. We want to thank you for your participation in helping us to provide what is needed here over the next years. In just a few minutes, I'm going to be speaking to this conference, and we're going to show you part of that message. I hope you'll stay with us.
In many Arabic-speaking parts of the world, the gospel is not easily available. Satellite TV, radio, and the internet can overcome these barriers. Media is the key in today's world to reach people in the Middle East for Christ.
World.
Right, you are using the right tool in the right time, in the right place. You are using media in the Arab world, and this time is the openest time for the Arab people to come to Christ. A lot of people are making their journey and searching for something else. There is a big number of people, especially young people and especially women in the Arab world.
I believe having Arabic program is an answer of prayer. That's exactly what we need in the Middle East. There's so many people and the satellites is everywhere. People have access to the media and of course the internet and everything. But they need this kind of teaching which have like it's go break into their minds whether they're male or female, and it has that revelation the from the Bible.
Well, good morning. It's a wonderful privilege to be here with you this morning. And we have a television program that's called Living Truth. We broadcast in about 60 nations around the world, and we translate into Spanish and also into Arabic. Our program is called Hakika Haya, and we have a technology that looks as though I am speaking very good Arabic, but I'm not. In fact, I drove into my gas station to get some gas in my car in Canada about a month ago. And there was an Arabic lady who was working behind the counter. She said, I know you. You speak Arabic. No, not me. She said, yes, I saw you on television. I said, oh, Alkama TV? She said, yes, Alkama TV. So it's not just through the Middle East, but wherever Arabic communities are in other parts of the world who can tune to the satellite television. Now, I want to share with you from the scriptures this morning, and I want to read from Isaiah chapter 1. We will read verse 2 to 4, and then I will look also at some later verses in a few minutes. Isaiah 1 verse 2 says, Hear, O heavens, listen, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I reared children and brought them up, but they have rebelled against me. The ox knows his master, the donkey its owner's manger, but Israel does not know, my people do not understand. Ah, sinful nation, a people loaded with guilt, a brood of evildoers, children given to corruption. They have forsaken the Lord, they have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him. When you go to visit your doctor, his first task is to make a proper diagnosis of your illness. If the diagnosis is wrong, the remedy will be wrong. If you have chest pains and he says you have indigestion, when you're really having a heart attack, it could cost you your life. And Isaiah opens his prophecy very careful to give a proper diagnosis of what is wrong with the people of God. Now, I want to go to the clinic of Dr. Isaiah this morning. Isaiah is concerned for the people of God. He's speaking to the nation of Judah. God calls them my people in verse 3. And we know that under the new covenant, the people of God is the church of God. And so this is a message for us, for the people of God. And I want to look at three things. First, the diagnosis. Then the symptoms. And then the medicine, the remedy. Let's look at the diagnosis first of all. In verse 3, he says, the ox knows its master, the donkey its owner's manger, but Israel does not know. My people do not understand. He says, the people of God do not know me. Now, if you asked somebody on the street, an Israelite on the street, do you believe in God? They would say yes. Do you know what God did in your history? They would say yes. He brought us from Abraham. He led us out of slavery in Egypt. Oh, we know all about God. But they did not know God in a personal, living, dynamic way. In the second part of verse 4, he says, they have forsaken the Lord. They have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him. Now, there's a slippery process in that verse. They have forsaken the Lord. They have neglected him, first of all. They spurned the Holy One of Israel, which means they resisted him. And now they've turned their backs on him. There has come a breakdown in their relationship with him. Above everything else, God seeks relationship with us. He is not just using us to fulfill his purpose. He wants a relationship with us. The Christian life is not defined by our experiences or by our doctrines. Those are important, but it's defined by our knowledge of God, our relationship with God. Now, we Christians talk about this quite often. But do we really have a relationship with God? Where we know him and we know we're loved by him and the Holy Spirit is at work in our heart. About 2 years or so ago, I was going through quite a difficult time. And my wife asked me a very penetrating question one evening. She said, is Jesus your friend? I thought for a few minutes. I said, well, he is my business partner. I work with him. Most of my business is about knowing his word, about seeking his mind, about experiencing his power, about ministering him to others. She said, but is he your friend? I said, I never thought that way. And she said, I don't think he's your friend. He needs to become your friend. And it was a huge challenge, and it's been life-changing for me. Jesus said, I don't call you servants. I call you my friend. We are servants. But it's much, much more than that. You see, Israel had a good business partnership with God. He gave them Canaan. He led them. They cried to him for help. But they were not in a love relationship with God himself. Back in Exodus chapter 19, when God led Israel out of Egypt, he said to them there, I brought you to myself. Not just to Canaan, to myself. You will be my treasured possession, he said. You will be for me a holy nation. Meaning you'll be set apart to me. And the most important thing about the people of God under the old covenant and under the new is that we have a love relationship with God himself. And that doesn't happen automatically. We have to develop that relationship. It's like a marriage. A marriage doesn't just happen. We develop the relationship. Sometimes when I conduct a wedding, I talk about togetherness in marriage. And I say there are two kinds of togetherness. One is a side-by-side relationship. You are going somewhere together. But there's also a face-to-face togetherness. That's not about going somewhere. That is just the two of you. where you look into each other's eyes and you love and you care and you nurture and you look after each other. And marriages can very easily become just a side-by-side relationship. We're busy, we have our job, we have our family to look after, we have to maintain the house, and we have no time for the face-to-face, where our hearts are open to each other, where we can be weak and vulnerable with each other, where we feed into each other's hearts, and it can be like that in the Christian life. I live a busy life, as many of you do. And as a pastor, we are taken up with the Word of God because we have to teach it. We are pointing people to Christ all the time. Busy, busy, busy. And we have a quick, God, please bless me today. Amen. Busy. But no time to be alone. And you know, that destroys marriages. And it destroys Christian living. And so they have forsaken the Lord, says verse 4. They've spurned the Holy One of Israel. They've turned their backs on Him. The face-to-face has become a back-to-back, and they've turned their backs on Him. Now, in verse 3, he says, the ox knows his master and the donkey his owner's manger, but Israel does not know. Now, how does an ox know its master? By familiarity with it. How does the donkey know its owner's manger? By familiarity with it. Can you imagine a couple getting married, and at the end of the wedding, the husband says to his wife, I'm going to go out with my friends tonight. We are going to play football. So I don't know what you're going to do, but after we play football, we are going to have some pizza, but we will come back later. Next morning, he gets up early. Me and my best friend are going to go off for the day today, but I'll see you when I get home. And suppose he lives like this. And then 3-4 months later, you say to the wife, how's your marriage? She says, it's terrible. Oh, why? My husband's never here. We never talk. We never do things together. That's how you can treat God. That's how the people of God were treating him in Isaiah. And I tell people many times that the most important thing about your Christian life is your own relationship and love for and from God. It's not about Christianity, it's about Christ and knowing and loving Him. Well, that's the diagnosis. What are the symptoms of this? Let me read you verse 11, Isaiah 1, verse 11. The number of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough of burnt offerings, of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. Verse 13, stop bringing meaningless offerings. Now, this is interesting. He talks about the multitude of your sacrifices. There are lots of them. Plenty of burnt offerings. Offering rams and lambs and bulls and goats. Well, didn't God institute that for the people of Israel? The answer is yes. But these rituals are only valid as they point to realities. And when you lose the realities, you overemphasize the rituals, because the rituals replace the realities. When I look around this church this morning, I love the fact there are no icons, pictures, symbols. We have a cross. But this is minimal outward ritual. Why? Because this church will believe in the inward spiritual realities as the all-important thing. But the less spiritual reality, often the more physical outward ritual, because the ritual replaces the reality. So he says, this multitude of your offerings and sacrifices, they do not impress God. You simply are busy, busy, busy with them because you do not know God. And so the outward things have become more important. And you make up in quantity what you lack in quality. You know, we can so easily do that. We don't have many rituals in the New Testament, but we have a few. We have communion that the Lord Jesus told us to celebrate. He took bread, you remember? He said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." There's nothing magic in the bread. It's to reveal to you me. He took the glass of wine. "This cup is a new covenant in my blood," he said. "Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So the symbol is the bread and the wine. The ritual is the eating and drinking of it. But the reality to which it points is Jesus himself. It's a remembrance of me. Now, what happens if a person takes communion who doesn't really know Christ? He's never been forgiven and reconciled to God. Can they eat the bread and drink the wine? Yes, they can. But what happens? Instead of the ritual pointing to the reality, the ritual replaces the reality. So the all-important thing becomes not, have I remembered Christ, but have I had it, communion? And we become superstitious about it. Oh, I'm sick, I must have communion. And we think there's something in the ritual itself. What about baptism? It's a beautiful picture in the New Testament. It portrays our union with Christ. That his death is our death. His burial was our burial. His resurrection is our resurrection to walk in newness of life. And a person who is baptized is saying, I have died with Christ, I'm buried with him, and I'm risen to walk in new life. It's like a wedding ring. It doesn't make it happen. This ring doesn't make me a husband. If I take it off, I don't cease to be a husband. It's just a sign, it's just a symbol. Baptism is a sign, it's a symbol. Now, I know some Christians baptize babies too, and that's okay. They see it more like an engagement ring. Not married yet, but our prayer is that this child will come to know Christ. When I was 16, the church I attended in England, they announced there would be a baptism in a few weeks. And somebody came to me and said, "You're 16, it's time you were baptized." I thought, yeah, why not? Everybody is baptized usually, trying to say. So I got baptized. I remember going into the room at the back of the church. I was soaking wet. And I thought, what was that about? Nobody said to me, "Do you know what it is to die with Christ? To be buried with him? To have risen with him to walk in new life?" I wish somebody had asked me that. They just said, "It's time you got done." Because the ritual had become more important than the reality. What about reading the Bible? When you become a Christian, people say, "You must read the Bible." Rightly so. I was told that. But I wasn't told why. I thought you read the Bible to get to know the Bible. But that is not the reason. And we read the Bible to get to know Christ. That's why Jesus criticized the Jews for reading the Bible in John 5:39. He said, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you possess eternal life, but they bear witness to me and you refuse to come to me." You study the Bible to know the Bible. It makes you Pharisee. But the purpose is that you know me. I have a Toyota car at home. When I got it, I had a little manual that came with it. I read some of the manual. Why did I read it? Not to get to know the manual, but to get to know the car. I could have read a little bit of the manual every night when I went to bed. I could underline the bits that I like. I could memorize some of it. I could put it to music and sing it. I could find a Toyota fellowship of people who own Toyotas. I could go every week to the meetings. We could study the manual. I could learn Japanese and read it in the original language. But one day I would say, "I am tired of the manual, I'm bored with it." Why? Because the manual is designed to point me to the car. The written word leads us to the living word. And as we read it, Jesus becomes more real, because the ritual of reading the written word is designed to point us to the reality of the living word. And then thirdly, let me talk about the remedy, the medicine. The diagnosis is, they do not know me. They don't know me. The symptoms are, you just have an abundance of rituals, but no reality. Now here's the remedy, the medicine. Verse 18, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Notice, by the way, God says, let us reason together. He doesn't just impose, that doesn't touch your heart. Here's what you need first. Your sins need to be forgiven. You've got to come and deal with me about that. You know, they engaged in all the rituals of offering bulls and rams and lambs, but they weren't dealing with God themselves. You know, many Christians deal with the church, but not with God. They listen to their pastor, but they don't deal with God. One Sunday morning, a while ago, in the People's Church in Toronto, I was at the front talking to people at the end of the service, and there was a man who said, I'm going for an interview tomorrow. I'd like you to pray. I will get the job. I said, but why don't you pray yourself? Why didn't you ask the person sitting next to you in the seat to pray for you at the end of the service? He said, but you are my pastor. I said, I will pray with you, but please don't think that my prayers are more important than yours. In fact, my praying for you could be a barrier to you dealing with God yourself. You outsource your prayer to me like you outsource your medical needs to your doctor and your finances to your accountant. You see, Jesus didn't say, please send your prayer request to me. No, he said, you go into your room, shut the door, and you do business with God. Paul didn't write and say, please send your prayer request to Ephesus. No, he told them, you have access to God. One of the great themes of the Reformation in the 16th century was the priesthood of all believers. That every believer can access God, not through a priest, not through some other mechanism. Now, it is good to pray for one another. And it's good to pray together, and this is a prayer conference. But Paul said, we all have access to the Father by one Spirit. So he says, now reason with me. One last thing. God has had to purify, not completely in this life, but purify the church through pressure, through persecution, through circumstances that are difficult, that has driven them back in greater dependence upon God, where people have had to get right or die spiritually. I don't know what God is doing in the Middle East, but I know this, that God doesn't just ride over the top of his people. He brings his people back to a fresh intimacy with himself. And out of that flows the blessing to other people. And I believe God will do great things in this part of the world, here in northern Iraq. We've met some wonderful, godly people here this last week. The first 11 chapters of Genesis were all based here in Iraq. The Garden of Eden, up to the Tower of Babel. Abraham came from Ur of the Chaldees. The seeds and the roots are here. May God bring again such a spiritual revival that the last part of the story is also here. So what is the film? And we will pray with you to that end. May God bless you.
Media is particularly suitable for Arabic-speaking people to learn about Christ because it can be viewed in private, on a mobile device, and on the internet. People can find out the answers to their questions in safety. We want to consolidate our Arabic ministry by developing the website, radio programs, and online response team.
Christian channels are very important. When I used to go to masses, I wasn't able to understand all the teaching I heard. Many things were confusing, but in the television programs, they simplify things for us, and that helps me understand much more.
I think that television is very important in Middle East because usually the woman, she stays at home. They don't have anything to do, just watch TV. Satellites help many people to know about Christianity. I hope this helps people to open the eyes and open the heart to know about God and about Christianity.
You are watching For the Kingdom of God, Living Truth in the Middle East.
On today's program, we've met a man who is prepared to pay the price of becoming a Christian. We've seen how important it is for pastors and church leaders to get together in Iraqi Kurdistan so they can receive teaching, encouragement, and prayer. We've seen how your donations have been put to work. And we met Ashti, whose story shows how television is playing such an important role in the Middle East today. Next week, we're going to Lebanon, east of here and on the Mediterranean coast. We're bringing some inspiring stories from the capital city of Beirut. So we'll see you next week. Bye for now. God bless you.